Right. In the previous video, I explained why giving your children or providing for your children good character is the greatest gift that you can give them. And in this video, I'm going to explain how. And when I explain how, I'm not so much saying that there's an absolute standard that children will reach in terms of hard work and self-discipline, compassion, but rather you're setting them on a trajectory of growth. And so the how has to do with putting them on this pathway of excellence. That's character development, is a pathway of excellence, and it lasts lifelong because you never attain good character per se, but good character implies being in a pathway of excellence in which you are growing, thriving, and flourishing. Now, I'll also mention, if this is the greatest gift, this might be the greatest labor you're going to engage with. And the reason why is there's a number of components why this is such a difficult task to develop character in children. Well, one, because we're talking about a process of growth. And therefore, it's not attainment like you graduated from high school or college, or you got your master's degree, or you got your PhD. Those are attainments. Or you went up the ladder of success in your profession. Those are all attainments. But this is a process of growth of which there's no absolute ending to it, but it's ongoing. And it's the growing that creates the sense of fulfillment, the sense of satisfaction, lifelong. And so within that process of growth, you're going through a cycle, which is very often filled with disappointments, failures, the need for resilience and bouncing back and growing again. And then the cycle continues, no matter which of the virtues you're trying to cultivate in your children. And that's part of what makes this task so difficult, whether we're talking about parents or we're talking about teachers, because it's always changing by the circumstances the child is in. And it also requires a constant reassessing, adjusting what we're doing. What you do at age six with a child differs when they turn 8 or 10 or 12 or 14. And you've even got to become creative because you're unique and your child is unique and your relationship is unique. And so what you have to do to cultivate these virtues and habituate these virtues to become good character, there's always an adjustment and you have to pay attention to it. It can't be done part-time. It's your whole job is to cultivate either in your children or in your students, this kind of attitude toward the pathway of excellence, the development of character. Every child is so different and they need creative approaches from the ones guiding them based on creating that pathway of excellence. Variables change. Not only the child changes, but the circumstances change. So we have in mind the qualities, the virtues we're talking about that are unique, not unique, are common to every human being. The courage and the goal setting and self-discipline and compassion, all the ones that we've brought up before are met with different circumstances and different children. You know, I'm reminded of some parents, I missed probably about 20, 25 years ago, having a terrible time with their 15-year-old daughter. She just hated everything. She hated mom. She hated dad. She hated her teachers. She even hated God at that moment in time. She was filled with bad feelings. And so the parents gave her a 6-week vacation. And this vacation was on a little kind of a mission trip to the highlands of Bolivia. Very poor area in which she would do, you know, she would be a part of a group that was helping the community with all the things to improve. And so she had to live without any 21st century amenities. The living circumstances were hard. She lived in a place that had a thatched roof, outdoor plumbing, no indoor plumbing, just one thing after another, 6 weeks she spent there. Well, it's interesting, when she came back, she loved her mother, she loved her father, she loved her teacher. She was grateful for every opportunity she had in her home and in her community, and was a different kid. What was it? That was, not everybody can do that. I wouldn't have done that for my children. It didn't fit. But for that circumstance, it fit. And the parents' creative approach, how do we cultivate and grow those good virtues in our daughter. And that was a step that they took. Recently with my sixth grade students, I'm watching a movie called Wonder. And it's about a little boy who from birth was deformed, facial deformity. And you could just imagine the trials he had to face in life. So the parents had to figure out, how do we still develop the character of hard work and discipline and compassion for others and not end up being a victim, though his circumstances were so difficult. And they had to find a way. And they did. By their own commitment, their own adjustment in thinking, they guided him. With my eighth graders, I watched a movie in the fall called The Miracle Worker. It was a story of Annie Sullivan as she tries to coach Helen Keller out of her blindness and deafness. The approach that mom and dad had taken, the Kellers had taken, was not working. Yet they didn't have the creativity to approach it. So they needed Annie Sullivan to bring another view on how to work with their daughter. And once they saw it, the light bulbs went on. And of course, we know the history. Helen Keller became an outstanding humanitarian and author, for that matter. I read about 3-4 years ago, one of my daughters recommended the biography of Michelle Obama. Beautiful story. Growing up in a tough part of town in Chicago, her parents had a different set of circumstances, but they wanted their daughter to have the qualities that she'd grow lifelong and thrive and flourish. So they too had to be creative based on their environment and based on their daughter. So you can see when you can take this task on, this is a huge commitment, because you're going to be discovering all along the way, who is that little boy or girl in your household, or if you're a teacher, who are these children that I'm trying to teach and discover something about them, so that when you're cultivating character, you take into consideration the unique circumstances. Now, I list three components in the work that we do to cultivate character in children. The first one is just teaching. They need instruction over and over again about what are the virtues, compassion and justice and hard work and self-discipline, all the things I've mentioned before, to learn them through stories, through actual experiences, through movies, great quotations. There's an ongoing instruction, either real life. Sometimes best stories come from mom and dad or the teachers. My students love to hear the teacher this experience, my own personal experiences. It affects them. I've read stories from Reader's Digest. There's great sections in there. You're constantly teaching. And why do you do that? Why the teaching has to be there? Because it awakens them. You remember, the potentiality is in every child that's common to mankind, humankind. And because it's common to humankind and it resides within, it's their potential. And so when they hear or see stories of exemplary behavior, of courage and so forth, all those kinds of things, their heart is awakened. And they say, I want to be like that. Not because we've taught them top down, but because we've called out of them what's within, that potential that's within. You inspire them, you awaken them because of sharing some of truth. And then what you're hoping for, and what generally does occur, is they begin to align their own will and their own sense of commitment to fulfill their own potentiality, to become a hard worker and to be a person of gratitude, to be a person of success, yet humility. They hear it, they aspire to it, and little by little, they bring along their own personal willpower. You can't overpower that. They've got to choose, I want to be like that. And stories awaken that inside of them. Then secondly, the teaching is important because it is a reminder. You know, it's interesting about speaking good things to people. It seems we can say the same thing over and over again, and we rediscover how wonderful it is. I've noticed this in this 4M program we have at school, where I'm just introduce kids to good stories about good people. And always, you know, some of the conclusions are, you can almost guess what they're going to be at the end of before the end of the movie. There'll be something about compassion and kindness or redemption, some good characteristic. The interesting thing is we need to be awakened to that, reawakened to that again and again and again. Vice works in the other direction. You do nothing, they're still going to build habits and build up attitudes over time, but they're not going to necessarily be virtuous. What's going to happen is they're going to be influenced by negative influences, sometimes just from themselves. They just don't want to become a hardworking person or to exercise self-discipline and so on and so forth. So there has to be a reawakening. So many times you will teach the same lesson hundreds of times if you're a teacher, hundreds of times if you're a parent. I remember a humorous story when I was driving my oldest daughter to college. And of course, I'm scared to death sending her away to college. And I'm thinking to myself, okay, what do I need to teach her? What do I need to tell her? And so I began talking about some character issue. And I got about three sentences into the paragraph and my daughter says, "Dad, that's enough. That's lecture 58. I've heard it 100 times. Well, I laughed, but that's okay. I finished the lecture. We need reminders. You know, that's why we enjoy good literature that brings back simple lessons on humanity, on beauty of humanity and virtue. They need to be repeated again and again, and it reawakens us. Oh yeah, that's right. I have to work hard. Oh my gosh, I forgot. I've got to have self-discipline. Yikes, compassion. I was hardly compassionate in that situation. The teaching, the instruction over and over and over again. I would say, as long as you're alive, you and I are alive, it should come out to our children and to our students, because it brings them back to an awareness. That's right. That's who I am. That's what I want to be. And in this then becomes the third component of teaching. You're giving to them reasoning of why you behave that way. It's not merely that we tell them you've got to be courageous and self-controlled and have compassion. That's okay when they're little. You just do it. You just practice it. It's rote. You're learning habits. But as they get older, you're teaching for reasoning, to shape the way they think. There's a reason why we've got to be courageous and set goals. There's a reason why we've got to learn to control ourselves, or we give in to our lower instincts. The reasoning shaped the conscience. And the conscience is really what backs up why we do what we do. Conscience, the word conscience means with knowledge, both in its Greek roots and its Latin roots. And so it lets us know when we're living according to our potentialities, we feel alive. We set a goal, we worked hard at it, we just feel alive, much more than some temporal enjoyments. And we also feel badly. We feel oppressed maybe a little bit, sometimes guilty that we fell short. It's a good feeling. See, if you've got the knowledge, that's a good feeling. If you know you have not done your best job, that's a good feeling. It's a failure, but you're able to bounce back because you have that knowledge in your conscience. Same thing with compassion. If we do not adequately teach compassion and empathy for other people, they have no feeling when they're in their 20s or 30s and they hurt other people or hurt groups of people or have opinions or biases or prejudices. But when the conscience is shaped, they'll realize, I shouldn't have said that. I shouldn't have done that. I shouldn't have taken that position. The conscience is awakened to what is right. That's the purpose of teaching. Then the second component in our work is to train. And that is to give practice. Because if you'll recall, good character is the sum total of all the habituated virtues. And you cannot make these virtues habit unless there's been sufficient practice. And so you need to establish some kind of a structure that teaches them how to behave. You know, at home, it's the chores. They have chores to do, they do them and they do it well. And they're reminded, and my goodness, don't you have to remind them hundreds of times to do the same thing over and over again? Well, that's both teaching and training. And we're persistent at that, because we know it's practice that will create the habit. Sure, at home, they're still going to try to avoid you. But I've noticed, and I've told parents many times, your struggles at home, sometimes we teachers enjoy the fruits of that at school, because the habits kick in and it's hard to get away from them. Schoolwork is the same way. You go to school, even regardless of the caliber of school, you do your work, you do it well. You listen to your teacher, you get along with your friends over and over and over and over. They get the teaching and they get the training. That means you're checking on them. You're observing how they're doing. You're asking them about it. Because that is the practice that they need so that what we tell them in teaching becomes their practice and habit. I was reminded, I read a biography years ago about Teddy Roosevelt when he was a little boy. He was from a very, very wealthy family. The Roosevelts did not need money. Everything, their lives were secure in that regard. But his father took him once a week to a kind of a soup kitchen for the poor. And every single week, they would see the people who are living on the other side of life in America and the hardship for the families, for the children. And he saw that week after week after week. And, you know, the little that I know of history, I'm not a great historian, but Teddy Roosevelt, though he was a very conservative politician, he embraced the compassion from his youth that he had to be instrumental in moving along the progressive causes in the early 20th century. So it practice is what makes them gradually a part of who they are. And it continues all the way through. Then the last feature of our work with children is what I would call creating culture. Culture at home, culture in our classrooms. And what kind of culture is that? This is, I hope you pay special attention to that. You would think when I'm talking about character, we're saying a culture where there's excellence and you're always the best and we produce the best students and I produce the best athletes, et cetera. That's not the culture. It's primarily a culture of humility. Because when you're on the process of growth, you are growing and you're proud of yourself. I'm so proud of my students who excel in writing, who excel in mathematics. Even some of them win awards. That's fantastic. You want to see them excelling like that. But that is not the culture of developing character. That's a piece of it. The culture of developing character is a culture of humility, because you always know there's a further distance to go, no matter what it is, no matter what you achieve. Sometimes I like competitions, and I'll give some messages on this later on the value of competitions with children. If nothing else, it creates that sense of humility. And so the primary drivers of that culture, forming that culture, we teachers, you parents. And what is the culture? Humility. The children need to know when you've tried to do things, when you've tried to improve, and when you fail. My students love to hear the stories about my inability to control my weight because I love chocolate chip cookies and I'm ashamed of myself. But they laugh, they giggle, but they realize, no, it's not merely reaching the goal. That's a part of it. You do want achievement. You want success. But there's rediscovering through failure. There's a rediscovering. There's a ways for me to go. There's a rediscovering of how to treat people, to recognize what you said to that person, the opinions that you voice. That's not right. That was wrong. So what do you do about it? Yeah, you're guilty. You're a little bit embarrassed. Sometimes you're even ashamed. But by golly, I want to grow. And if you'll recall, this is the essence of developing character, is there's no end. It is a pathway of excellence toward growth. And the environment that creates growth is one of humility, where we're always rediscovering what we can do next. We embrace our failures. We find resilience and we move forward. Yeah, I hope this is helpful. In the future, I'm going to go into more detail about the specific virtues, at least how I define them. There's many, many more definitions. Mine's not unique. And then how we work at each one of these to help our children develop good character. Thank you.